All right. You guys ready for number 50 here?
Let's do it.
Number 50. Let's do it.
Number 50.
15.
That's a lot.
15-y. 15-y. That's crazy. It's kind of nuts that we've been doing this pretty much for a year now.
For a year. Yeah.
Not to get ahead of ourselves. But.
Oh, God.
Hey, including those beta episodes. We're there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Save me, Mr. Taco. Save me from that game.
That poor game is at the bottom of the eShop at this point.
That poor game is at the bottom of the fucking barrel. That is one of the worst games I've ever played.
That game's even worse than Kirby's Dream Land 3.
It's easily.
So... Hey, everybody. Welcome to Pursuing Pixels. This is episode number 50. My name's Kevin Portelli, and I'm here tonight with Randall Nolery.
Hey, everybody.
And John Hines.
Hi.
And we're still locked down under quarantine. We are recording two episodes in one night, so who knows where the state of the world's actually at when this episode comes out. Right. But hopefully things are in better shape than they're in now, or we're at least on the right track.
Fingers crossed.
But, hopefully everybody's doing well, staying safe and everything. But since we're all locked down under quarantine, we've at least John and I, and then, you know, we've mentioned before a couple times on the podcast that we play in a band together, or at least, you know, we have played in a band together. I've been kind of struggling to recover from a hernia surgery that's kind of kept me from getting back to it 100%. And then on top of that, we're all locked down under quarantine. So we're all just kind of missing hanging out and stuff. So we were kind of looking for an excuse to play some games together, and I think we've definitely talked about Diablo III on the podcast before, Randall and Tina playing that together as a time sink kind of situation. We played, John and I played, I can't remember if we talked about this on the podcast or not, but played like one night on New Year's for like a brief, I literally don't remember anything about that. I played for like maybe 20 minutes. And then, so we finally decided our buddy Glenn got a Switch. And so everybody in the band now has a Switch.
Nice.
And we were able to play four players.
Nice.
And, we went in, Glenn and I kind of went in blind essentially, me with just that tiny bit of experience. And then John and, Mikey essentially ushering us through the experience. And yeah, I don't know. There's a lot going on. It's definitely a tough situation to just jump into blind.
Kevin, did you play before you started like I told you to?
I know. Randall gave us the heads up. He said, hey, why don't you give it a try beforehand? Get a little bit
of loot. Get a little experience.
We decided we all went in with a new character.
Okay.
So we all went in with no.
Okay.
You know, I think you do get to carry over some things, like Mikey was saying, his like money or his gold or something carried over.
Well, that's
I believe,
a huge
John.
Advantage.
My blacksmith level had carried over at that
point. That's a huge advantage, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. So like, so there was some things, but like for the most part, we start out with no gear. Sure. Like I was the monk class.
Okay.
Which starting out was not super great, but as I unlocked a few, but like, you know, it definitely gets confusing. You're unlocking like, obviously you're just getting all kinds of loot.
Yeah.
And then on top of that, all, you know, all your loot and your weapons and armor and this and that gear that you're wearing, it all has different stats. And then on top of that, you're getting like secondary tiers to all your abilities that you're unlocking, and like this runes or something. I don't know what the fuck everything's called, but like it starts to get a little bit confusing, like to the point where like when we were done playing, like I definitely had a good time. We probably played for like 2-3 hours or so.
Nice.
We played for a while. Played like through, I don't know. I don't know if is that the whole map that we were looking at, John?
We almost finished Act 1. So like the way, like the game is still like, I'm in Act 3 in my main playthrough. And like I created this new character for this, but like we got a decent way through it. But like, yeah, nice. We're pretty much like, you know, there was a lot more time of, you know, Mikey and me explaining like certain mechanics, or like explaining like, oh yeah, like these are the cooldowns that you have. These are the different, like you have your skills, and then the skills themselves have like secondary abilities that you unlock as you level up. But like, I don't think it was so complex that you didn't understand what you were doing, or like,
no. I mean, I wasn't 100% lost, but like in terms of like, the menus. And it's something that I think if I spent maybe an hour or so by myself playing and just like really familiarizing myself with the menus and all the different, like Randall said, I know. But like, you know, just familiarize myself with all the different like perks and different stats and whatever, just so I can like kind of glance over. Cause like, you know, John and Mikey were talking about, oh, I can just like use the D-pad to equip new items that I get that are clearly better than the stuff I have. And I'm like, I kind of get how that works. Like I saw how it was implemented, but like I didn't trust my instincts to just be like, yep, that's better than what I have. And like, I would like to know the menus that well. And I think if I, you know, took the time to learn them, I would, you know, but we were just kind of breezing through and just kind of blowing through, but it's definitely a fun button masher. You know, I will say stuff that I've played, you know, stuff in a similar genre. Like I used to play with, so in a previous band that I was in, actually, we used to play the X-Men Legends games back on like PlayStation 2 and Xbox. And like those, again, I grew up on X-Men and Marvel, a little bit of the Marvel stuff, but particularly X-Men.
Yeah.
But like I feel like I would maybe get a little more enjoyment out of something like Marvel Ultimate Alliance, like just with a little more. I just like that personality, I guess, more than like this hellscape demon deal, but it's definitely fun. I just thought it was maybe a little bit too much going on in the menus personally. I know that's kind of the point of the game, but I personally wish it was a little bit more streamlined.
That's where all the fun is, Kevin. Loot. It's in the menus. You look at the numbers, you compare the numbers. These numbers are greater than these numbers, and you equip it. So it's so much fun.
And that's what Forager was all about. You know, it was all about just min-maxing, you know? But like, I at least felt like I was like kind of producing. So I'm not trying to take a big dump on this game or anything, but like, I just... And I'm looking forward to playing it again. We were already texting like, hey, when are we going to do this again?
You gonna stick with your monk?
I think at this point, I mean, I'm level like 14 or there you so. Go. I think
we no, got up you're to level like 23.
No, like
or
22.
Something.
Yeah, it was like 22 or 23 by the time we stopped.
Nice.
And yeah, I mean, I'm enjoying the character for the most part. And I think there were like what 7 different character classes at this point.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's nothing. I guess I just don't see the hype of why Diablo is so great. But I had a good time playing it with friends, I guess. But if I was just playing it by myself, I'd be like, I don't understand. But I also was just breezing through the cutscenes and not paying any attention to the story. So
when it was like multiplayer controls and like anybody could advance the text, like didn't matter who it was. So basically one of us at any given point was like pressing B to just mash through it.
Yep. Which is fair.
I mean, you want the experience. What's that?
Oh no, yeah, we beat a main boss and like I think you mashed through it and Mikey was just like, oh, the story's really good.
Yeah, he was like, the story's actually pretty good, guys. And I was like, oh, I thought that I was just controlling my screen. Because I know you guys had mentioned, like, all the loot, you know, is, like, specific to each player, which is really cool. But
I will say, like, for the regular dialogue with, like, whatever non-playable characters or mini-bosses, like, yeah, we don't read that shit or listen to it. Like, but if it's a cutscene, yeah, you leave that alone. You watch that cutscene.
Yeah, and it's pretty solid voice acting and everything. You know, nothing. It's definitely the presentation is top notch.
Yeah.
And I do appreciate is like all the different gear you get actually makes your character look different. Like you actually wear the gear. Like it is such a bummer when you get all this awesome looking gear in your menu or your pouch or what, you know, when you're going through your stuff and then you like equip your character with it. And it's like, oh, I still just look exactly the same, or I don't have that awesome weapon in it. You know, I just have the same. You know, so I do appreciate the level of detail in that regard.
That is there's a big there's a lot of the fun to be had just like looking different and looking more badass because you got some new crazy glowing bleeding sword or some dumb shit like that, you know.
Yeah, and especially when you start off just like when you start off like in your robes basically, you know. It's cool to definitely like, okay, now I got this crown and all this crazy equipment, so.
Yeah.
Diablo 3.
Yeah,
really
I guess
good.
What's that?
Diablo 3 is really good. Yeah, it's true.
It's solid. I definitely enjoy it. And I'm looking forward to playing more, but I don't see myself other than like taking a little time to familiarize myself with the menus single player. It definitely doesn't seem like something I will explore on my own very often.
No, and I wouldn't play it on my own either, honestly. If Tina and I weren't playing it together, that's not something I would play single player by any means.
Yeah. All right. Good to know. So Diablo 3 is a good multiplayer experience. Yes. But,
exclusively.
But why don't you take us a little deeper into the depths of hell, Randall, and talk a little Doom 64.
It's a nice segue there.
I do what I can. I do what I can.
Yeah, so this relatively recently got released on Switch and Xbox One and PS4. I'm playing it on Switch, and I'm actually playing Doom 64 for the first time, despite being a pretty huge Nintendo 64 kid back in the day. And I actually remember that I was offered this game for $5 from another kid I went to school with, and I didn't take him up on it at the time for some dumb reason. I couldn't tell you why. He was like, "Hey, you want this for $5?" I'm like, "Oh, it must be a joke." Like, no, I don't want it. Must not
hey,
be
five
very good.
$5 when you're a kid too is yeah, like it's a little different than today. You know,
that's true. That's a lot of the allowance right there.
Yeah, know, so it is the allowance,
right? If you got one in the first place. So yes, whatever reason I did not play it at the time, despite like it got pretty good reviews at the time. I guess I had the misconception, like I think a lot of people did, that it was just Doom ported to Nintendo 64, because a lot of that was happening too with like StarCraft. StarCraft and things like that, exactly. So I thought, you know, that's more of that. Like I've played some Doom on DOS back in the day, you know, I get what that is, but now finally it's come out on Switch. I think it was $5. I'm like, yeah, sure, why not for $5?
That's what I didn't pay back in all those years.
Right, exactly. Got my $5, and now I've played it. I've got more.
Yeah, with inflation, you got a pretty good deal there.
That's true. That's a good point, Kevin. More like $15 these days. Yeah. So I really got a great deal, honestly.
Yeah, you got a steal.
Especially because they've done a lot to update this release. It's not just like, you know, put it in an emulator for Switch and, you know, wash your hands and be done with it. No, they took the time to update this thing. They added things like motion controls, which I haven't tried too much of, but they also added new levels apparently, which you know.
Oh man.
Yeah. You can't access them until I think after you beat the game to what I'm kind of seeing. I don't want to spoil that for myself, but it seems like it's a big tie-in with the new Doom Eternal game, which is really cool that they like would take the time and love to do that with Doom 64. So I'm like, okay, you know, $5. I've always had an interest. Let's start it up. Everyone says it's an underappreciated gem. And yeah, it is. It's really good, guys. Like it is just Doom like on Nintendo 64 with new levels and a new campaign, but it's really good. It's super well crafted. Like it's still like there's no Y axis control. Like you can't look up and down. Like the old retro Dooms, but it's fine.
Yeah,
like, I already knew that going in, and to some degree, that kind of streamlines things, right? Like it makes it easier to quickly like aim and shoot and make decisions in like a frantic Doom game, which this is. In a way, I can see the DNA of what ended up being Doom 2016 in this game. In like the pace of it. Kind of exploring the levels. There's a lot more exploration, even kind of like a Metroid thing going on that way where, which was the case in some of the earlier Doom games too, where like, okay, go press this button on the wall, which opens up this other hallway. You go get the yellow key card. Then you can come back across the level. Right. So you can open the yellow door and then you can continue on. Oh, there's another key over there. So you can go back this way across the level. You know, oh, there's new bad guys. Oh, there's the, you know, these bigger guys that'll take you out in a couple hits. So be careful, but you know, you kind of know the level now. And yeah, it's just like simple and straightforward, and it's just hitting the right retro buttons for me. And like, I really want to see this thing through, and I didn't think I would get that hooked, but I kind of am. I'm into it.
Yeah, because like at $5, it does seem like I'm just kind of curious. Like I might pick this up just to check it out, experience it for a few minutes or, you know, an hour or so and be like, OK, got my $5 worth. So that's cool that it's got you hooked enough, because I think they dropped, I think, Doom 1-3 and Doom 64. Right. At the same time or right around the same time.
Right around the same time. Yeah, I think. The first three came out kind of first, and then 64 just got dropped, I believe, relatively recently. But yeah. they're making the effort to put all these out, and you can tell that, you know, id Software has the love for these games.
Yeah,
like this is their heritage, and yeah, I'd recommend playing it for $5. I think it's one of the best Doom games. And it has a really cool, like, you can tell it's from a time period where developers used to take the time to do these like splash intros before the game starts. And there's this really awesome corny one where like you see all these characters and they're all sprites, but it's on like this 3D background and it's kind of swirling around to show this like massive war happening, and it zooms out and then you can tell like the level that it was showing you was actually just Doom. And it's just like in these like Nintendo 64 rendered style polygons, and it's like, oh, this is great and corny and just from its time, right? Like that they would put the effort into something like that. So it's just,
yeah,
it has a lot of that going on. It just, it hits my nostalgia buttons, but it's still fun to play now.
Nice. How far along are you into the game?
I'm in the third level, and I would say each level has been taking me about like 15, 20 minutes each.
Oh, wow.
So okay. I'm not like super duper far, but yeah, I just kind of started it last weekend. I'm like, ooh, wow, this caught me, and I did not expect to be caught by it. So I will play more.
Nice.
Yeah.
I'll be curious to hear more about that. Cause yeah, I played just a tiny bit of Doom, the like 2016 ish one that you guys talked about on the podcast a while back. Oh, yeah. I played it on Game Pass, just like the first level. So I need to play some more of that.
So a maybe this will, game.
Yeah, maybe this will give me the little nudge now that Eternal's out too. So
I would recommend it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, another game, we're just going to keep the D's going today, pretty much straight through the episode.
Yeah, right.
And we all picked up a game called Day and Night, which is a puzzle game,
like
a brick falling puzzle game. Yeah, block matching, brick falling. I don't know what they're called, but, you know, Tetris-ish style. But there's kind of a lot going on with this game, mechanics-wise, and I don't know. I think we're all pretty mixed on this game. And to be fair, we haven't all put a ton of time in. We basically played through like the tutorial.
But and then the tutorial like, maybe, is like, actually a little pretty bit. Substantial. Like there's there's like a lot of different mechanics in this game. Like,
yeah, it's like 40 minutes or so, I would say. I played a good chunk of time.
Yeah.
Playing the tutorial to the point where I was like, okay, I'll take a break, but I'm going to come back to this eventually.
Yeah.
I think, at least personally.
So it the day and night namesake is the like mechanics. Like there are like two blocks that are day blocks and there are two blocks that are night blocks. And you can only match those blocks while it is either day or night. And you fill up this bar at the bottom, like this meter, that as you like match more, like it fills it up. And once you reach that, then it switches over from day to night. And it does that for whichever player does it first. So I think they're almost all, except for the endless mode, like usually they're like versus matches where you're playing against another screen of someone trying to do the same. And then in addition to day and night, there's also like seasons where there are additional blocks that, you know, are based on whatever season it is. If it's like winter, like there's that does that releases a special attack on your opponent if you match those. Whereas
like there'll be like that'll like unleash like a row of ice blocks that like blocks, like it'll kind of stop anything from falling below that.
Yeah. And there's like those blocks as well. Like in addition to like the day and night blocks and the season blocks, there are those like the ice blocks where if you like, there's a quick set where, you know, it'll drop it down. It'll like create that block of ice.
Oh,
or if like you have a bomb, if you do a quick set, it'll like the bomb will go off. But like you can also,
whereas if you drop it softly, it won't blow up everything. Yeah.
Right.
Right.
So there, and then there, in addition to that, there's also I forget what they call it, but there's another meter where like the more combos you get, then that like will send more attack blocks. There's just, like, it's a very complex.
There's a lot going on.
Yeah, more than you think.
It's not overwhelming. At least I didn't find it overwhelming. I don't know how you guys felt about it, but I think the tutorial did a pretty decent job of like introducing each of the mechanics in a way that was understandable and like didn't feel like it was too much at any given time.
It was on the brink for me. Like, I was definitely where I was like, oh man, if this is getting complex. But it was also when I was getting the hang of it, or when I did like set up some decent combos. Cause like when it does change from day to night or vice versa, like if you have a bunch of bricks like if it's daytime and you have a bunch of night stuff set up, it, like as soon as it changes over,
starts going,
you can
ham.
Just chain a ton of combos.
Oh yeah.
And it's pretty liberal with, like, it's pretty much just if the blocks are connected.
Yeah.
I think if it's more than four, but if they're connected in any, not diagonally, I guess, but as long as they're touching another block of that kind, it'll eliminate all of them.
Reminds me of Puzzle Fighter in that way. I was definitely getting some Puzzle Fighter vibes as far as that aspect was concerned.
For sure.
Which is not a bad thing by any means.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It also has like similar like mechanics as like Puyo Puyo, where like,
yeah,
if it, like you have one like off the side of an edge, like it'll drop. They won't stay connected, yes, like Tetris. Like it'll always go as far down as it possibly can.
Yeah. Right. And they do a good job of like telegraphing where those will land with like the markers, you know, on the screen, I guess.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But I don't know. I personally really was enjoying this game. Again, I only played through the tutorial, and it did have some elements of it that weren't the greatest. You know, like I personally, I know, John, you were, again, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I personally like the presentation to some degree, the visual presentation. I like the art style. It's like kind of like this like theater kind of cardboardy cutout, but like kind of handcrafted style. The characters,
see,
there's a little room to, yeah, they're a little generic,
yeah,
but it's a puzzle game. I'm not looking for a ton of that. I'm looking for more mechanics than the design, and I do think it like is it looks great, you know, it has a high level of polish, I guess. If,
see, personally, I think puzzle elements of it, like the gameplay elements of it, I think look good, and I think have a good like cohesive like style throughout. It's just like those characters look so out of place.
Yeah,
I'm with John on this one. I don't think so. They don't stand out that much to me. I mean,
I think like they're so like solid block of color, whereas like everything else is, you know, I don't know, like has texture to it.
Yeah, that's okay. I see what you're saying.
It gives off a vibe like those are the assets that the developer put in there like temporarily while they were like building it out, and then like, oh, I guess it's good enough. Like, let's just run with that.
Especially like the vibe when they're like touting like as a selling point is like, oh, you unlock all these different costumes, and I'm like, why?
Yeah, I feel you there, but. I guess that wasn't, for me, that wasn't like a selling point at any point. Like, even when that was listed as a feature, I was like, okay, I don't care. But this just looks like a cool game. The thing that I will agree with you on, John, is the music is a little bit...
It's just free use, whatever, like, was non-copyright music. To like, because like I remember listening to it, like I was playing through a couple levels and like the Liberty Bell March by John Philip Sousa came on and I was like, if there's no reason for you to ever hear that music outside of the context of like the Monty Python theme song.
Exactly, and that's the point. It's like it does feel a little out of place. Like it just feels
extremely
like
out of place.
It just feels like, yeah, it's like, where's the marching band? And like, I don't know. It's just a little overly dramatic, and like, I don't know. It was definitely a game that I was like, yep, this is a podcast game for sure. I'm going to throw on something else I want to listen to while I play this game. But I do find the mechanics interesting, and I'm looking forward to playing it a little bit more. And especially, I'm never going to complain about a game I pick up for $2.
Yeah.
I will say the normal price tag is $20, and that it, like, if it was, if it had online versus and stuff like that, I think that would justify that price tag a little bit more.
Yep.
But the fact that it's only couch co-op, and maybe that is me leaning into that right now a little bit more, is like, hey, it's couch co-op, and like, I literally can't have anyone over at my apartment. Mm-hmm. So there's no value in that to me right now.
Right.
But, you know, I do think if it had that, that could justify it a little bit more. But I think for like $10 or less, again, it suffers on the presentation a little bit. But the mechanics wise, if you're into these kinds of puzzle games, I think it's still a solid game for sure.
Yeah, the presentation shouldn't be that big of a deal, but it is. Like, in thinking about my favorite puzzle games, and especially competitive puzzle games, all of them do have a great, really unique, well-crafted presentation. And I just can't say that about this one.
You're not wrong. Do you have, can you list a couple of those? I mean, I know you already talked about Puzzle Fighter.
Oh, yeah. Puzzle Fighter.
Which is a no-brainer.
What's Bust a Move 4 is another big one. Pokemon Puzzle League. Like, all these games have very unique, like, I can just look at a screenshot and be like, oh, yep, that's that game to a T.
See, and I still think this game has a unique style. It's not one that I love, but it's...
I don't even know if I'd say unique, though. It feels kind of like generic assets to some degree.
Yeah.
I don't want to get too nitpicky, but that's just like, it shouldn't be as big of a factor with puzzle games, but it is, at least to me. Like, that keeps me coming back to it.
At least for me, the thing is, like, if it had the exact same feel as the actual gameplay segments, like, spread throughout, like, I think I could get down with it. But I think the fact that there is, like, such a disparity in quality between, like, the, like, even there, like, there's animation on all the, like, when a block, like, the ice blocks go through, like, or when a spring block will connect and, like, there'll be a little, like, a little plant that's growing through it. Like, those are of a distinct style.
Yeah.
And then just, like, going to the menu and having that just not, that style not be present in any capacity, like, that's very jarring to me.
Yeah.
And it's a bummer because I do think, like, the gameplay is a, like, I think it's a really well thought out and
balanced.
Yeah,
I would totally agree with that.
It is, like, taking that theme of, like, day and night, and then, like you said before, John, like, adding the seasons even on top of that, and, like, really taking that as, like, as far as you can take it with a brick matching puzzle game. You know, I it's a very interesting set of mechanics for sure.
Deserves credit for that, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I do agree. I mean, I see what you're saying, where, like, it is a little bit of a shame that it doesn't have that extra edge of, like, that polish or that, like, or that just, like, man, this is such a unique experience, you know?
Right.
Mm-hmm. But still a cool game for $2. I'm not mad I picked it up. So.
No, not at all.
But speaking of some other games we picked up on the cheap, John has hyped up in the past the Diablo series, which both Diablo 1 and 2 I think were on sale for like $8. They're normally
six bucks.
Nice. Okay, they're like 80% off. That's what it was.
Yeah.
But yeah, they're normally $30, but I think they both originally came out on Wii, and these games have just kind of stood the test of time, I guess. They've come out on like PS4 and pretty much every system since.
Yeah.
The Wii. But how do they hold up, John? Or I think you've only really spent some time with the first, but...
Yeah, so I originally bought them both for Wii, and I played through both of them. I thought they were, like, really hidden gems on a, like... This is still when Nintendo didn't have, you know, huge third-party support.
No, not at all.
Yeah. Or at least third-party support of any quality.
And I think THQ published
THQ,
those?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
And that was a pretty relatively early Wii release, if I'm not mistaken. Not like launch or anything, but it was early enough to where it was like, hey, there's not much else. So.
Yeah. No, yeah, I think it came out in 2008, I think I looked up. Whatever year it came out 2 years before Despicable Me came out, because when I was watching the thing about the Blob is it has a lot of like cinematics before every level had like a unique cinematic that kind of told a story without any voice acting. So it was a lot of physical comedy, and all the Inkies are, you know, like Cyclops. So they all have like kind of one eye that also functions as like a mouth or like an expressive. So there has to be a lot of like animation and like character in just these no vocals, like, so there has to be a lot of I get what you're saying, though.
Same with Rayman with the rabbids and stuff. Why was that like such a thing at that time? Like,
that's a good point.
But it was
that's a good comparison.
They weren't doing a lot of voice acting, so there was just a lot of like physical comedy or physical acting. So yeah, like, the game is a 3D action platformer. You are the titular character of Diablo, and you absorb paint. The entire world has been sucked of its color and turned into this monochrome world where there's no sound, like there's everything has been turned into this like very bland world under this like fascist regime. And
everything's hitting home. Everything's hitting home these days.
And you are part of these revolutionaries and that are trying to bring color and music back to this world. And a thing that I really loved about it was it had this dynamic soundtrack where you would get these different primary colors, and whatever color you were was a different instrument in the music track. And they're typically all jazz or funk songs. So like,
cool.
Usually when you play, like if you have a red, that's like a saxophone, whereas yellow would be trumpet and orange would be trombone. So you get these, in addition to the primary colors, if you like get a yellow color and then you get a red, you become orange, or, and then you have the three primary colors, the three combination of those. And then the, if you combine all three, then you become brown, and that's almost always a record scratch. So like,
nice.
But they're all of them like flow so seamlessly in with the background music, and the background music starts really small and like quiet. Like the soundtrack to these games is just incredible based on like how much they had to really develop it to be like, okay, like there's this like quiet section, and then like they slowly add in more rhythm and more backing tracks, and then
like as you paint the levels, essentially, like the more that you're covering the levels, the more there's adding into the soundtrack.
Yeah. And like, that's cool. Like even when there'll be like different gates at different points in the level, and every time you unlock a gate, it kind of resets back because you'll go into this area that is kind of monochrome again. But like once you start filling that area up, like with, and like take care of enemies and do other things in that, like other objectives as well, like it just builds until this giant crescendo by the time that you're like beating the levels. And levels are long. And that was the thing that I kind of forgot about the game, was that like, even when you're, I think I'm at the point where there are like different objectives, and one of them is always like, try to beat the level as fast as you can. And some of them is still like, oh, I need to beat this level in under 18 minutes.
Oh, wow.
Like, so.
Okay.
And that's like speeding through, basically, and doing no objectives.
And like compared to other, like other than like all this like stylistic stuff you've been talking about, but like gameplay wise, what would you compare it to, like 3D platformer wise? Like, is there a touchstone that you can think of that it kind of compares to, or is it
not
a unique enough thing on its own? Or, but I mean, is it more like a Mario thing? Is it more like a Crash Bandicoot thing? Is it more like a,
it's a very Wii title game.
Where like, is it more like open world? I mean, obviously not. It sounds like there's like levels, you know,
it's kind of sandboxy. Like the levels themselves are pretty huge and they have different mechanics within them. But like a thing that like it really like took advantage of, at least on the Wii, was like a lot of the motion controls. And that's not very present at all on, like, I play it on a pro controller. I'm not sure if they're is like separate controls. I would doubt it if it's a port.
There's been a lot of games that have had that, like Okami, like we talked about last week, has like all the Joy-Con support for gyro, and maybe they have it in there.
You would typically target something, at least with a nunchuck, and then you would swing the Wii remote to attack, and like that lock-on mechanic is still there, but instead of swinging, you're just pressing the A button. So when you're playing the like this port on Switch, it does seem way simpler than it, like the original titles that were like, and I think that that is kind of to its detriment. I think it was a more engaging game when there was, you know, a lot more like moving around and kind of felt a little bit more engaged with it. I know that one of the things that I'm a little disappointed about is that like before, like you had to transform these landmarks with like a certain amount of paint points that you had. And the way that you would do that is like, you would literally shake the Wii remote and the nunchuck as like maracas,
right?
Like kind of too in tune to the beat. And now it's just mashing the A button.
Oh,
and it's
that's a bummer.
Yeah.
But like overall, like it, I'm still having a ton of fun with it. Like it's not a huge, like, difficulty spike. Like it's a pretty easy game. I think you can basically just move forward in the game, like, and not even need to like press any buttons. I think
like
I think,
it. So it's not like puzzly at all. Like you're not like solving little riddles or little puzzles and stuff. Or
there are challenges that are that offer that, but like those are not necessary to like technically beat the game.
Sounds kind of cool though. Like you're taking in the experience of the game. Like it doesn't always have to be super challenging. Like it just sounds like you're taking in like a soundtrack essentially that you're being interactive with.
And yeah, like there's no shortage of things to do. Like there's a free play mode where there's just no objectives. There's no just the level like as is. And like once you beat the level, you can just do that. And that's a fun thing to do. But like I think I 100%ed this game when it first came out on the Wii.
Nice.
And like that was a huge ordeal back there because like there's all these like side objectives that again aren't necessary to like beat the game, but like if you want to get every tree in the level, get like 100% of items painted in the level, or get all of the like collectibles, like they have them scattered all throughout, so like it does kind of like let you have its own difficulty based on what you want to do in the game.
Nice.
But for the most part, I'm really just playing it because I love the soundtrack and I love hearing it like just completely different every single time I play.
Yeah, even though you're not like composing it per se, it's like you kind of are at least a little bit in control of it, which sounds pretty cool.
It does sound cool.
It's very fun. I wouldn't mind giving a stream of it at one point because I think that would be a really fun thing to see because it is something that you kind of have to either watch or experience.
Right.
Like it's a little bit difficult to explain the charm of it without, you know, seeing it in action.
Yeah. Especially when the soundtrack is such a major factor. Yeah, it's just hard to explain otherwise.
Hard to put that into words.
Yeah.
Yeah. But good to hear that like a game from the Wii era holds, you know, stands up the test of time. It's like a lot of these games that took like a really bold, I shouldn't say really bold, but a pretty bold, you know, art style or art direction. You know, they stand the test of time, you know, instead of going for trying to make it look realistic. It's like, let's just make this super, like, I don't know if it's cel shaded per se, but it's just like really like,
distinct.
I don't know. It just, it's distinct. Yeah, exactly. Glad to hear that it stands the test of time for the most part. So
yeah,
that's sweet.
But yeah, I think we can pretty much wrap it up there this week. I know that, one more game that, I threw the challenge out to Randall, I don't know, probably like a month and a half, maybe even 2 months ago now,
maybe,
to play some Minute.
Yes.
Which we've all spent a little bit of time on, and we'll probably talk about it a little bit more next week, I think was the plan.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But
put it in writing so that we actually do it.
That's right.
Yeah.
Nail ourselves
just to
the
actually,
wall.
To keep that ball rolling so that Randall can kick the challenge our way. Because we all have spent a decent amount of time. I think we've all kind of hit a wall or something. Yes. But we'll get into it next time.
Yeah.
But yeah, a wall of some kind.
Yes.
But anyways, I think we could pretty much wrap it up there. Like John mentioned, every once in a while we're doing streams on Twitch. We'll typically upload those to YouTube. So just look us up. Jesus. Just look us up at Pursuing Pixels, and then you can find us on Twitter, Instagram at Pursuing Pixels or /Pursuing Pixels. And again, new episodes every Monday. You can find us at pursuingpixels.com. So, or wherever else you find podcasts. So we can pretty much wrap it up there. And take care. Hope you're staying healthy and safe. And we'll catch you next week.
See ya.
Take care.
Bye.
I was actually, today I was watching playthroughs of like Bit Trip. And just letting that play for 20 minutes.
Yeah, I saw you playing that little piano riff. Synth riff.
Because like I initially played it and I was like, what the fuck is this from? I remember it's from like a Wii era game. What was I playing that was like a like very synth heavy game? And then like by the time I posted, I was like, okay, I know it's a Bit Trip game. I don't know which one.
Yeah.
Aren't brains weird that way? That's crazy. Like you remember the song and kind of where it was from, but not the game really. Like
I mean, it took a bit, in between like me playing it and me posting that, like there was a lot of me just being like, what the fuck is this game?
a lot harder to search for sounds and songs.
Your brain, Yeah, and your brain somehow remembers Bit Trip Core being the best game in that series.
I don't understand. Because it's the best.
I don't know, man.
I'm just kidding.
Bit Trip Runner.
Definitely not the best, though.
Fuck off. Runner.
Bit Trip Runner?
First Runner.
No, Runner's garbage.
Runner is not garbage.
Runner is not garbage. The first one's the best, for sure, but...
No.
Yes, it is.
No, not the best of all of them, but the best of the best runner games.
Yes.
Oh, of the runner. Yes.
Yes.
I thought you were also saying Beat was the best.
Yes.
No.
The first one, Bit Trip Beat, is the best one.
Core, Flux, Beat.
Flux, I didn't play enough of, but it was cool. And Void was cool too.
Void. Oh, fuck, I'm thinking of Void. So I was Core, Void, Flux. No, Beat, Flux, Fate, Runner.